Shalom. Holy Scriptures and Israel is a ministry designed to share with the Jewish people the good news of the Lord Jesus, Yeshua the Messiah, and to instruct Christians on the Jewish roots of their faith. And now, teaching God's Word from a Hebrew Messianic perspective, here is Gideon Levitan.
Shalom, my dear friends. In this session is the second session that we study together as we are preparing ourselves for the study of the eight parables found in the 13th chapter of the Gospel of Matthew. I think it is very important for us to understand when we read in Matthew chapter 13, these verses 10 and 11, where the disciples came and said unto him, this is unto Yeshua, unto Jesus the Messiah, and they asked him, and they said, why speakest thou unto them in parables? And he, this is Yeshua, Jesus, he answered and he said unto them, because it is given unto you to know the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven, but unto them it is not. For whosoever hath, to him it shall be given, and he shall have more abundantly. But to whosoever hath not, from him shall be taken away even that he hath. Now I would like to share with you in this session this expression, the expression that is found in Scripture, especially in Matthew chapter 13, Mark chapter 4, and Luke chapter 8, the parables that deal specifically with the mysteries of the kingdom of God. Underline these, the word mystery or mysteries that we find here in Matthew chapter 13 and verse 11. Unto you it was given to know the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven. Why did the Lord Jesus, the Lord Yeshua, the Messiah, use this expression, the mysteries, in Matthew 13, or the mystery in Mark 4 and Luke 8? What is so mysterious about this mystery of the kingdom of heaven or the kingdom of God? We made sure to express already that when we say the kingdom of heaven and when we say the kingdom of God, we mean one and the same thing. The kingdom of heaven and the kingdom of God is simply a kingdom where God is ruling over the affairs of his creation. In fact, in the Word of God, and I would like to mention these for all of our benefit, in the Word of God we have five aspects of God's rule over the affairs of this world. In fact, let me give you those names. And these names are so. Number one, the kingdom of God over the universe. Number two, the kingdom of God over the redeemed people. Number three, the kingdom of God over his chosen people Israel. Number four, the kingdom of God over Israel and the world through the Mashiach, the Messiah, who is to reign and rule over this world. And number five, the mysteries of the kingdom of God. The last aspect of the kingdom of God is in this present age in which we live in. It actually began from the time that our people of Israel did not accept the Messiah at his first coming, and the nation of Israel forfeited the enjoyment and the blessing of the Malchut HaElohim, where God will reign through Yeshua the Messiah over Israel and the world. And it began when Yeshua was rejected by Israel as a nation in Matthew chapter 12. And here, chapter 13, he gives us the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven. And it will, you might say, the mysteries kingdom will end when the Messiah, Yeshua, are going to come at his second coming, according to Revelation chapter 19. And he will offer himself to our people, Israel, in these days of the tribulation period. And Israel as a nation will finally acknowledge that Yeshua, that Jesus, is indeed the Messiah who came once to die and was rejected, and who will come the second time to rule and to reign over Israel and all the world. And in between, it's so interesting, just in between the rejection of the Mashiach at his first coming and the acceptance of the Mashiach by Israel at his second coming, we live in the age, in an era that is called the mysteries of the kingdom of God. In fact, I want to read for you one verse or so, or two verses that apply to every aspect of the fivefold kingdom of God or kingdom of heaven. When it comes to the kingdom of God over the whole universe, we read in Psalm 103 and verse 19, a psalm that was written by David, the king of Israel, the psalmist of Israel, the sweet psalmist of Israel. David said in that psalm, "The Lord has prepared his throne in the heavens, and his kingdom," notice that, "ruleth over all." His kingdom ruleth over all. This is what is known for us to be called the kingdom of God over all the universe. In Hebrew, it is called Mamlechet Elohim al kol hayekum. God is ruling over the affairs of men, wherever man is, whatever God allow here in this world to be, because after all have been created by God. Everything belonged to him. He is the creator. We are the creatures. Everything was made for the pleasures of God, and therefore God thus rules over the affairs of men. He's sovereign. His providence is evident in this world, and even though we think that he is not ruling, in actuality, he rules, as Psalm 103 says, he is ruling over the whole creation. In fact, in Colossians chapter 1 and verse 16, it's speaking about the Mashiach. It says, "For by him, by Yeshua, by Jesus, by the Messiah, were all things created, that are in heaven, and that are in earth, visible and invisible, whether they be thrones of dominion or principalities or power, all things were created by him and for him." And in verse 17 of Colossians 1 it said, "And he is before all things, for by him all things consist or held together." Well, God is a king over his universe. This is the first aspect of the kingdom of God, the kingdom of God over the universe. Of course, secondly, God is still ruling, and even though men rejected him and men despise God and disobey God, yet God throughout the history of humanity, from Adam and Eve, Adam and Chava, some 6,000 years ago since the creation of this world and the creation of a man, and God placed them in the Garden of Eden, Garden of Eden in Hebrew, Adam and Eve disobeyed God and they have sinned. Well, they became sinners. And they needed to receive forgiveness, and for this God had to kill an animal and to cover their nakedness and their spiritual blindness and nakedness by the shed blood of this innocent animal. Genesis 3 verse 21, God killed an animal, its blood was shed, and its skin covered their physical nakedness. The blood of this animal was atoned for their sins, and they were forgiven. From their own beloved friend, they had two sons, Cain and Hevel. In Genesis chapter 4, Cain came to God on his own merit without the shed of blood, without blood atonement. And Hevel, his brother, came to God on the basis of the blood shed of an animal, and God forgave him. God accepted Abel, and God rejected Cain. And from their own beloved friend, we have the two lines, the godly line, the ungodly line, the forgiven line, the unforgiven line, the redeemed line, and the unregenerated one, unredeemed one. And so from there on, all the way till today, God's kingdom is not only over the universe, but also over all those that are redeemed and forgiven. In other words, God is also ruling spiritually over the people who repented and confessed their sins before him. In fact, if you remember to Nakdimon, this ruler of our own people, the Jewish people, God drew him to Yeshua, to Jesus the Messiah. And when he came to Yeshua, and he said to him, "We know that thou art a man that came from God." You remember what the Lord Jesus the Messiah said to him in John 3 and verse 3? Jesus answered and said unto him, "Verily, verily, I say unto you, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God." Malchut Elohim. One has to be born again. Born from above. Born by the Holy Spirit. Born on the basis of God's forgiveness through the substitution of animals in days of old, which pointed to the Mashiach in our days, and therefore God is still ruling over the hearts of all those that are truly redeemed. From Adam and Eve until today. And if you are not a believer in Yeshua the Messiah, and you are not redeemed, you have to turn to him, because the precious, precious blood of the Mashiach, Yeshua, paid for your sins and mine. Without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness of sins, because the blood maketh an atonement for the souls. And therefore, the second aspect of the kingdom of God is not only that he rules over his universe, but God is also ruling over everyone that is a true child of God, redeemed through the atoning death of Yeshua, Jesus the Messiah. In Hebrew, it is called Mamlechet Elohim al Kol HaGeulim, or all those that have been redeemed and forgiven. But there is a third aspect of the kingdom of God, and this is very clear to us from the book of 2 Samuel chapter 7, from Exodus chapter 19, from Deuteronomy chapter 7, and this called the kingdom of God over the nation of Israel. To remind you, my dear friend, that God have chosen a nation, Abraham, Yitzchak, Yaakov, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Yaakov's name was changed to Israel, and God gave to Jacob 12 sons. These 12 sons had, out of them, God had provided a kingdom for Israel. And you remember, the 12 sons of Israel, the Hebrews, our people of old, were slaves in the land of Egypt. God redeemed our people of Israel out of bondage, and God had brought the Hebrews, the Jewish people, to Mount Sinai. And from Mount Sinai on, God have began to reign over one single nation known as the nation of Israel. In fact, in Deuteronomy chapter 7, we read, "For thou art a holy people unto me," verse 6, "or unto the Lord thy God, for the Lord thy God hath chosen thee to be a special people unto himself above all the people that are upon the face of this earth. The Lord did not set his love upon you, nor choose you because you were more in number than any people, for ye were the fewest of all people. But because the Lord loved you, speaking of Israel, and because he would keep his oath, or the oath, which he had sworn unto your fathers, has the Lord brought you out with a mighty hand and redeemed you out of the house of bondage and from the hand of Pharaoh, king of Egypt, and so on and so on. So God is now ruling over the nation of Israel, one nation, the nation of Israel. He gave to our people of old the law, the Torah, and he began to reign over the nation of Israel there and then by Mount Sinai, when he instructed one nation to keep the Torah, the instruction that he gave to the nation of Israel. And of course, the Torah pointed to the Mashiach that will come in the fullness of the time. But one nation was to be ruled by God himself. God later on, you remember when Israel wanted to be like the other nations of the world, God said to Samuel, they have rejected me from being to rule over them, for being a king over them. And from there on, he gave them a King Saul to be a king of Israel, and then David to be the king of Israel. And the kingdom of Israel continued until 721, the northern kingdom was taken captive by the Assyrian. 586, the southern kingdom of Judah was taken captive by the Babylonian to the diaspora dispersion. And the kingdom was handed over to the Gentile world, and the times of the Gentile began at 586 BC, when the last king of Israel that ruled over Israel on behalf of God was there. And from there on, beloved brothers and sisters and dear friend, Israel as a nation had now no longer having a king over them. And since 586, actually until today, Israel, most of our own Jewish people are still scattered all over the nation of the world. Even though we today, since 1948, there is a nation called Israel, praise God for that. But if you remember, when Yeshua came at his first coming, he offered himself to be as the king of Israel, to have the messianic kingdom, and Israel forfeited that messianic kingdom. And so we can say now that the fourth kingdom is really the kingdom of God, or the kingdom of heaven over Israel and the world. And God now, when Israel was being taken captive by the Babylonian to Babylon to be dispersed, we read in the prophet Jeremiah in chapter 23, there is a promise to Israel that God one day will raise this messianic king, the Mashiach himself, and that he will one day rule over the nation of Israel, and to his kingdom there will be no end. We read in Jeremiah chapter 23, "Behold, the days come, says the Lord, that I will raise unto David a righteous branch, and a king shall reign and prosper, and shall execute judgment and justice in the earth," not only in Israel, but all over the earth. This is the promise of the messianic kingdom. "In his days, Judah shall be saved, Israel shall dwell safely, and this is his name whereby he shall be called, Jehovah our righteousness." The Lord is our righteousness. Adonai Tzidkenu. This is the fourth aspect of the kingdom of God, in which God promised Israel that one day the Mashiach will come and will reign over Israel and all the world, and he will rule in righteousness. And there will be no more any time of a rejection of God. He will rule in righteousness. And this was the kingdom that the Lord Yeshua, the Messiah, offered to Israel at his first coming when he said, the kingdom of heaven is at hand. But as we remember that we have already read in chapter 12 that of the Gospel of Matthew, Israel as a nation did not accept the Mashiach Yeshua at his first coming, as it was already foretold by the prophets of Israel some years before, when Isaiah said that when the Messiah will come at his first coming, Israel as a nation will not accept Yeshua the Messiah at his first coming. And here we can see that Matthew 12, we read in verse 28, but if I cast out the devil or the demon by the Spirit of God, the kingdom of God is come unto you. The kingdom of God is in your midst, Israel. But Israel did not accept the offer of the Mashiach at his first coming. And therefore, beloved friend, the kingdom of heaven have been forfeited by the nation and postponed to the second coming of the Messiah. And at the second coming of the Messiah, at the end of the 7-year tribulation, Israel will finally receive the Mashiach Yeshua, and Israel as a nation will be established, and a king, the Messiah, will reign in righteousness over Israel and all the nations of the world. In our next session, I would like to speak about the fifth aspect of the kingdom, which is called, according to Matthew chapter 13, the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven. And then we will continue to take the parables, one parable of the time at the time of the mysteries parable found in the 13th chapter of the Gospel of Matthew. Well, beloved friend, until next time, God bless you. Shalom, shalom.